Can you see my screen also?
Yep, everything is
Okay.
good.
So I'm Nestoras. I'm going to present the IQzip, which is an application for lossless IQ data compression. We developed it together with Costis from Giarlio for the SDR Makerspace. A roadmap of this presentation, we're going to talk about what motivated us to do such a thing. And we will discuss a bit about how the algorithms work and what results we got and how we compare with other known algorithms. So, source coding in general can provide a lot of benefits. Some of them are the reduction of transmission channel bandwidth, reduction of storage equipment, and that was our main focus with IQzip, and reduction of data transmission time on given rate, which wasn't what motivated us to start implementing this application, but we will see later on how we can also do that. And the main question is that we have a lot of files that are distributed in a compressed state, like images, music, etc. And can we do that for IQ data? The answer was yes, so we will present how we achieve that. First of all, IQzip follows the standard defined by CCSDS 101.0b3 book. It wraps the Libre library, which is an implementation for the encoding algorithm compliant to the standard. The main coding part uses the RISE adaptive entropy encoder, and also there is a preprocessor functional part before we put the to preprocess the input and pass it to the adaptive entropy encoder. We also extended the header beyond CCSDS compliance to allow users to use options that wasn't supported by the standard. So let's start with the preprocessor, which just takes the input of n-bit samples that we have and partitions them into J sample blocks of n-bit samples. The CCSDS uses a simple unit delay preprocessor, which means that we compare the sample that we have now with the previous samples, and we calculate a prediction error, which is the difference between those values, which then is passed to an error mapper, because we are trying to achieve that the most common difference is zero, then the second most common difference is plus one, minus one, and so forth. Also, the first sample is usually used as a reference sample and is unprocessed. The reference sample has a parameter to be at specific intervals between other samples, and that changes some of the results that we will see later. Here we see a simple graph of the unit delay predictor. We see the input that is going in. We calculate the difference from the previous sample, and then we pass it through the error mapper. In general, what we have after the prediction error mapper is the first sample, which is unprocessed, and the other samples that are the calculation of the error. So to move on to the adaptive entropy coder, the goal of the coder is to calculate uniquely decipherable codes for each block. How it works is that it has multiple codes, different algorithms that run concurrently, and we choose for each block of samples which was the best. So we also have to add an identifier to know which algorithm was used for a specific block. And this is the Rise encoder, which needs the block size, meaning the number of samples that we run the same encoder algorithm, and the sample resolution, which is how many bits every sample has. And also the ID bit sequence we to identify the, which algorithm we used. Here is the graph of the adaptive entropy coder. We can see the options that gives us. I won't go into details in the presentation, but you can ask me later about the differences. And so to validate that the CCSDS algorithm for compression is usable to our case, we have to compare it with other algorithms, lossless algorithms. Some of them are the shorten, FLAC, which is well known and used for music, and LZ77 and LZMA. Most of them use different type of encoders and also preprocessors. For example, shorten and FLAC use a linear predictive preprocessor, which we will gonna also evaluate later on. We used the real IQ observation data taken from the Satnox network. Some of the modulation that you that were used was
Nestora.
Yeah, the audio is gone.
Yeah.
Just when he was getting to the good part.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was really anxious to, hear about the comparisons.
Hello?
You are back.
Where did you lost me?
A slide before this. Okay. Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, because there are various lossless compression algorithms, we wanted to evaluate each of them and how it compares to the CCDS. Some of them uses different codes for preprocessing and encoding. For example, FLAC and shorten use a linear predictive for the preprocessing, and then shorten uses a Huffman encoding. The LZ are Ziv-Lempel encoders, so we're gonna see who performs better. We ran our test from IQ data that we captured from observation from Satnox network. We have various modulation schemes that were used. For example, we have CW, JFSK, and APT, because we wanted to evaluate that our algorithm is working properly independent of the modulation scheme. And we also wanted to explore how parameters from the algorithms contribute to compression. Here is a comparison between the algorithms. The compression ratio is the compressed file size divided by the original file size. So less is better. And we can see that the CCSDS has a little bit worse performance than the shortened algorithm, and it's better than the others. We prefer to have a standardized algorithm and follow the CCSD standard, because we're going to send also packets that are compressed, and we didn't care about that minor difference with shorten. Here you see the block size is the block size. We talked about the number of samples that are given each time to the encoder. And LPC is the linear predictive coder that some algorithms like shorten and flag use. And here is one, because we wanted to compare it with the unit delay that CCSDS employs. Now we're going to see some the effects of the linear predictive coding from the proportion from flag and shorten. We can see that for flag, and also on the x-axis, we have a block size, and we want to see how it affects our compression ratio. From what we see here, we see that flag has a lot of overheads, because it's used for music and have a lot of information on how you can play a song from a specific part, and that's why it works pretty well with bigger block sizes. On the other hand, shorten doesn't have so much an overhead to the compression. So we see that above 64 block size, the differences are minimal, almost non-existent. And also here we evaluate the difference between the filter size, and as you can see, it doesn't affect the compression ratio so much. Although we would like to explore adding a different preprocessor to our app, which is also compatible with the CCSD standard, because you can have application-specific SIMs. The effort to achieve that wasn't, we didn't think we deserved it to do it. It was too difficult for the gains. Now we'll go to the next part of the presentation, which is how CCSDS packets the data so we can have so we can also transfer the compressed files. What we have is the coded data set, which has the encoded part of the file. The coded data sets are of variable length, so we have to have some information about the size of each CDS to know when the file is over and it's sent completely. Also, the ID of the encoder is included for each CDS. There's also an option to have a subset of the code used to minimize the overhead from the ID. Also, the reference sample that we mentioned earlier is also inserted at the first CDS, and every R, which is the reference sample interval to the next CCSDSs. And then the CCSDS are packaged into packets, and this is the overview of the package. We have a packet primary header, a secondary header, which is optional, and then we have numerous CCSDSs. And if because we must be byte aligned, we have some fill bits that could be added at the end. So there is also the compression identification packet, which is when we want to send a compressed file through the network, we have this optional packet, which provides the necessary information for decompressing and must precede all other data packets. And we will discuss a bit about its fields. We have the grouping data length field, which is a measurement of how many packets we have, so we know the end of the CCSDS file. We also have the compression technique identification field and the reference sample interval field, so we know in how many CCSDS we're gonna see the next reference sample. Also, there's the source configuration field, which has the most information about the compression seam and gives us all the information we need about the to do the decompression without prior knowledge of what was used. And also, there is an extended parameters field that is also optional, that we can set the block length sizes above 16 samples and reference sample interval above 256 CDSs. And also, we must have the extended parameter when the restrict code options are used. So, what we also added was an extended header that is appended after the CIP header if we have some parameters that exceeds the specification from CCSDS. And that was done because although the CCSDS has fields that you can set that my preprocessor or my encoder is a specific mission application, meaning that I have to know and the people who will receive the packet have to know the differences. We tried to create a new header so that is not necessary, so there is no knowledge about the application specific parameters. So some of the changes that we can have a block size of up to 65,535 samples. In the CCDS standard, that value is 64. And also, we have an extended reference sample interval, which for CCSDS standard is 256. Here is the list of the available options for the IQzip. We have the J, and which is followed by the samples, the bits per sample, the reference interval block, if the samples are signed, if we use the restricted set of codes, and we can disable the pre-processing while doing the compression. If the samples are signed or we want to use the restricted set of codes or we want to disable the pre and post processing, that is optional fields, and the default is that we don't use them. On the other hand, when we decode, we just run with plain D option and we don't need to know anything about the compressing process. So to conclude this presentation, the IQzip provides a CCS compliant lossless compression app. No a priori knowledge is needed for the decompression, which we found, we thought that is pretty important. We achieved about a 50% compression for IQ data using the CCSDS. And it's lossless compression, so it's not that bad of a number. It's pretty good, I would say. Also, the IQzip could be extended with different preprocessors and encoder, either by using the CCSDS standard specific application values or through the use of our extended header. And also, during the creation of the IQzip, at some point we have created a SIGMF wrapper that can encapsulate the compressed data, which is used right now for Satnox to admit the data to the observations. But we decided that we don't want to be to imposing a specific wrapper for the data files. So that was all. Thank you. If you have any questions.
Thank you, Nestoras. There is a question about the comparison with the Z standard.
Yes.
Done and
what is the Z standard? I'm not sure.
Neither am I, but flame wires can probably take the mic and explain or provide a link to it, and we can move on to the next one. It's a compression algorithm by Facebook, apparently. Okay.
I don't know about that, so I don't have any measurement. I have no idea how it works and what could what compression ratio could achieve.
Cool. Next question is a comparison with SZIP, which is provided with HDF5.
The SZIP, I think it uses some of the LG that we compared, correct me if I'm wrong. But as you saw, the results are worse than our implementation. CCSDS standard, actually.
Okay. There's a question about the latency penalty for IQzip.
I don't recall the number exactly. It's not very time consuming, mostly because the observation files are not too large. From the top of my head, we are a bit slower than Shorten, but I think we are faster from the other algorithms, both in compressing and decompressing. Unless it means during sending the packets, which I have no number whatsoever.
Cool. And I think a final question that I can see here is regarding not lossless, but rather lossy compressions, and if those are possible, and how the performance compares, which is a broad question, I suppose, but yeah.
Yeah, we have thought of that. We haven't implemented anything because it's outside the CCSDS standard, and it will probably work well because at least in the observations that we have, that is from LEO satellites and stuff like that, the signal bandwidth is a lot narrower than the channel bandwidth. So if we had a way to compress the noise, for example, remove it completely and then add the random noise, which doesn't affect our signal, probably we could have great results for compression.
Okay, Stefan is asking if you can save 50% of the size when zipping the IQ samples. Doesn't that mean that you could just remove a bit of your sample size?
I don't think I understand completely the question. What do you mean by removing the sample size?
Oh, probably that requires, as Manoli says now, a priori knowledge to that. But...
Actually, if I understand the question and it has to do with dynamic range, we don't have to know it. Some of the encoders actually take that into account because imagine you have a huge dynamic range and your values don't go from minus to plus near those values. When we do the prediction during the pre-processing, those ranges that are not useful, they're going to be pre-processed and in a way removed from the from our samples.
And actually, if I recall well, Nestoras, we have seen observations that do not have large variations on the dynamic range because no signal or just the noise floor. Having a smaller file size than, for example, the APT observations.
The CCSDS standard specifically was created with APT in mind. It was for image compressing. And we just tried it and it worked also for other applications and modulation schemes.
And I think there's another question about how much an a priori knowledge would improve the compression ratio.
I can't answer that because, first of all, we are trying to not have any a priori knowledge of the compressed signal, so it's easier for the decoding, the compressing process. But that... I mean, we tried something like that, like the dynamic range that I discussed in the previous question, and we said, okay, we have the samples. Can I do a different pre-processing for input? That would be, I will remove some numbers. And we didn't have better results because the encoder is good enough to find out those discrepancies, let's say, and achieves a good compression ratio.
And I think that the final question would be if you can supply floating point input or does it have to be integer?
You can supply a floating point input, although I'm not sure how will that it will go. Our numbers are mostly with integer values. Probably with floating points, there are going to be some issues, but I'm not sure. I have not tested that.